Hi, hello dear students, how are you? I hope you all are fine. We all know that this is an increasingly challenging time, a time of distraction in our lives. Not only in our life, the entire world is going through this phase. First of all, I want to congratulate every one of you for staying back at home and following the guidelines of government. The knowledge and wisdom gained from our elders helping us to fight against this pandemic situation. It is truly said that education never takes rest. It is a continuous process of learning. With this enthusiasm, today you all came forward to utilize your time to improve your knowledge. Taking this as an opportunity, I am presenting my first online lecture on evidence. As we are meeting after a long time, today I want to give a brief lecture on introduction of evidence and the salient features of the Indian Evidence Act. Actually, Britishers, when occupied our country, faced so many problems in adjudicating the cases because the panchayats at that time used to decide the matters basing on the personal laws. To overcome the problems facing in the country, they started to introduce their own legal system in the country. As a part of this, Indian Evidence Act was passed by the British Parliament in the year 1872. And this Indian Evidence Act, passed by the British Parliament, set forth the rules of evidence admissible in the Indian courts. You all know that the corpus juris, that is the body of laws, are of two types, substantive laws and adjective laws. Substantive law deals with the rights and liabilities of a person, whereas adjective laws deals with those points, those systems which facilitate the realization of the rights and liabilities. If you carefully observe the Indian Evidence Act, you can understand that this act is having the features of both the substantive law and the adjective laws. Now, let us see what are the salient features of the Indian Evidence Act 1872. This Indian Evidence Act 1872 is having 11 chapters and comprises of 167 sections. And these sections and chapters are divided into three parts. Part 1 of the Act deals with the relevancy of facts, and Part 2 of the Act deals with the proof and the kinds of the evidence, and the last one, that is the Part 3, deals with the production or effect of the evidence. And this Act came into force on 1st September of 1872. Here you are having one important point to note, that this act in the year 1872, when passed, is applicable to the whole India. Whole India means at that time India includes Pakistan also. Hence this act is applicable to both India and Pakistan. Even after 1947, also this act is applicable to both India and Pakistan up to 1984. In the year 1984, Pakistan repealed this act and enacted another Evidence Act for their country. So this act is applicable to all India except Jammu and Kashmir. And of course, as you know, recently after the amendment of the constitution, now this act is applicable to Jammu and Kashmir also. And this act mainly applicable to judicial proceedings that are going to take place in a court. Here the two points you have to understand are: judicial proceeding means what? The second one, which one is a court? Court includes all the court martials also, other than those courts which are convened under the Army Act, Naval Discipline Act and Air Force Act. And this act particularly does not applicable to affidavits which are going to be presented in any court or officer or arbitration. And this act is, as a, it is made by the Britishers, applicable to India, but automatically because made by Britishers, it is based on British law, that is English Evidence Act. But a few exceptions are there, basing on certain conditions, which we will read while going through the sections. And Indian Evidence Act applicable to both civil and criminal proceedings. Here, when the act is applicable to both civil and criminal proceedings, there is a difference in applicability of the act, because civil cases, what is meant by civil law and what is meant by criminal law? First of all, a civil case will be filed by a person. It will start with a plaint or a petition, and it ends with the decree or a judgment by the court. For this process, two parties' presence is must, and one person will submit a plaint or petition, and the other party will submit his reply in the form of a written statement. Later, trial of the case will start, where both the parties are going to submit their evidences, and after hearing the parties, examination and cross-examination of both the parties will be done by the advocates of their own advocates and the advocates of the other party. After that, finally, basing on all the evidences submitted by both the parties, arguments presented by both the advocates, court is going to decide the matter basing on the principle of preponderance of probabilities. Here, the burden lies on both the parties equally. And basing on preponderance of probabilities means there is no need of proving the case completely. Maximum points are going to be taken into consideration in favor of a person, and basing on those points, court is going to give the judgment in favor of that person. Which are crucial points, which points court is going to take into consideration, these things will be explained by the court in the form of issues framed by the court after submission of the written statement. Whereas in criminal courts, criminal law is completely based on a complaint filed by a person. After submitting the complaint in the police station, that police officer, if thinks there is a case in it, he will register it as an FIR, and from then onwards, he is going to submit the matter to the court. Once the matter when comes to court in the form of FIR and charge sheet, it will be handed over to prosecution. So, police role is limited up to charge sheet, submission of charge sheet. After that, prosecution will prove the case. And here, public prosecutor is going to decide who is going to be the witness and how the trial is going to be conducted. And prosecution witnesses will be examined by the court. And the accused is having the liberty to take a decision regarding his admission or his submission of evidence. And after 313 examination by the court, if accused feels he is comfortable, then only he will come to the witness box. If an accused is not coming to the witness box, he is not at all liable to answer any questions to the other party or to court. And even if he lies, even if it is proved that there is a false statement, there is no punishment for the accused. And the burden is on the prosecution completely, and prosecution is supposed to prove the fact beyond reasonable doubt. If any doubt is created in the mind of the court, then acquittal for the accused is a must, compulsory, 100%. Now, you can understand, most of the cases, if you observe, people goes on saying that 498A, misusing by the ladies, and SCST's Atrocities Act is misusing. Is it really misusing? If so, why the sections are not removed? The simple reason behind this is that in criminal court, the case will be filed by the police officer, and he is submitting 161 statements and charge sheets. At the time of submitting the charge sheet, FIR, 161 statements, if there is any technical mistake, basing on those technical mistake, prosecution is going to lose the case. And after submission of all these things by the station house officer, SHO, mostly sub-inspector, prosecution, when a public prosecutor is conducting the trial of the case, he is at liberty to make alterations to the case of the police. Therefore, The complainant who filed the case is not at all having a right to appoint her own, his own advocate. And they are completely depending on police to some extent, after that, on public prosecutor completely. And these two persons are going to decide the fate of the case. It is a completely, a judgment will be given purely basing on the technical grounds. Hence, it is very difficult to win a case. Beyond reasonable doubt, if a case is proved, then only a case can be completed. How a party can know? How a party can submit all these things? Because at the time of filing the complaint, what is the state of mind of a person? They don't know all these repercussions of what to write in the complaint, what not to be. Without knowing all these things, they are submitting a complaint to the police, and that complaint is going to become an FIR, and later it is going to decide their fate. It is why not only 498A or SCST Atrocities Act or any other act, in most of the criminal cases, if you observe the judgment, court will write that prosecution failed to prove the case beyond reasonable doubt, hence we are acquitting. Court will never say that we believe that he is a honest person, but court will say that because prosecution failed to prove, we are giving acquittal to the accused. This is what the most important thing to be understood. And the next important thing to be noted is that this act is not an exhaustive act. This act, along with some other acts which supplement the Evidence Act work, those acts are CRPC, CPC, Bankers Book Evidence Act, Stamp Act, and Indian Limitation Act. This act completely deals with the subject of evidence. Hence, it is going to decide what is meant by evidence, the definition it gives, and it consolidates, it amends all the laws relating to evidence. Under these circumstances, if any particular evidence is excluded by this act, it is not going to be admissible in any court at any circumstances. Even if it is essential to ascertain the truth, it cannot be admitted because it is excluded by the act. Next point is that this act stipulates that evidence in a court must be given of facts in issue and relevant facts alone. Facts in issue and relevant facts. Apart from these two, if the party wants to explain some other irrelevant points, court is not going to take them into consideration. Then you may get another doubt here that which one is relevant and which one is not. Which one is a fact in issue and which one is not. For this, when you are submitting the first copy, that is the first complaint or plaint or petition, whatever it may be, when you are submitting something at the first of the case, that itself will decide whether it is a fact in issue or not. If you forget to mention any particular issue in that plaint, you cannot add it in your case in the later stages unless the other party and the honorable court gives you the permission for that additional addings. The act is dynamic in nature. It is why it will evolve with the time. The latest enactments, Information Technology Act 2000 and Criminal Law Amendment Act 2013, brought some changes in the Evidence Act also. Let us see what is the meaning of evidence and how many kinds of evidences are there. The expression evidence is derived from the Latin word evidentia, which means being clear or apparent clear. This Latin word evidence or evidentia, evidere, which shows that anything clearly showing or which is used to prove or discover clearly is an evidence. It means the simple thing is that anything make plainly and to ascertain to prove the fact. Because of this significant role played by the Evidence Act in court matters, This law is known as the lex fori, means law of the land. And in tomorrow's class, I am going to discuss some more important points relating to evidence, that is what is meant by a fact and how we will presume before the court relating to the facts.